Turn with me in your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 2. Y'all know this verse by heart? Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. Y'all know it by heart? Let's say it together. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Then, of course, verse 10 tells us, it's really like a poet. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God has prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Western culture, modern day culture, and world values tells us that you and I are wrong in what we've been taught and what we've been raised to believe, that there's one way to heaven. Western culture and many universalists believe that there are many avenues, many roads and avenues to eternal life, and that Christianity and the Bible's way is one of many ways. They all lead to the same path. How do you know that that is wrong and that it is not true, that there are multiple ways to heaven? Because the Bible declares it to be true. And the only thing that we have to rely on is God's word. In John 14:6, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me. Proverbs 14:12, Solomon wrote, there's a way that seems right to man, but the end thereof leads to death. So you might have heard, you might have been told that there are many ways. When I was out in California, I used to love the different diversities of people who believed in lots of different facets. It was so interesting to sit down with people and talk to them about their religion and what they believed. And I sat with this one gentleman two or three times who would tell me, he was a deist, and he would tell me that there are many ways to heaven. And I would ask him these questions, because here's the thing that I learned as a kid. Anything that's not true, the more questions that you ask about it, people will fumble in trying to get to the end of their truth. The Bible is true because it's not your word or my word. It's not our opinion. It's God's word. And God's word is truth without any mixture of error. So I remember this fellow would get to the end of himself. And after a deacon and I were there one time, I just left it for him to think about. And I left him with some questions. I said, if you'll read this little book, and I handed him the book of John, if you'll read this little gospel account, when we come back in about a month, you have more questions for me and I'll have some more questions for you, and we can learn from one another. So he invited us back 2 weeks later. We went back and we talked more. By the time we were there three times, he had so many more questions, not about Christianity, because he had read the Gospel of John, but he couldn't answer his own questions about his faith and what he believed. Now, this was the hard thing. His wife was a Christian. She did a lot of women conferences, and she loved to use her husband as an illustration of how he was lost, though she was saved. And as he asked us these questions, it was amazing to me as I told him the gospel and gave him the answer straight from God's word, not my opinion, but reading it to him right out of God's word. He was so convicted, he got on his knees and asked the Lord into his heart. And when I got up from my knees, I thought his wife would be hugging us and happy. She was mad. She'd lost her illustration. I think that's lots of times how we approach church, though we would never think of that. There are lost people outside of these walls. They're nothing like you and me. They don't think like you and me. Our ways are absurd to them. It's not even natural to them. It's foolishness to them to the worldly, what we believe and take as truth, it's very foolish. And we look at their ways and we wonder, well, that's folly. That's nonsensical. It doesn't make sense. But only way that you're ever going to show them the truth is when they read it from God's word. And when you take a falsehood and you compare it with authenticity, people see the truth and they sense it through the power of the Holy Spirit. He's hard to deal with. He'll knock on their heart's door. So there's lots of people who think lots of ways. Down in Florida, there was this big church near our home that was a universal Unitarian church. And they think that there's just all of us are God's children, that everyone in the world is a child of God because we've all been born into the world and we're all children of God. And while there is true that God so loved the world, his beloved is the bride. Those who accept him and do not reject him, he loves them, but they are his beloved. Like you have a wife, you have a husband, you have children, you have grandchildren. They're special to you. Why? Because they're of your same blood. When you become a part of the brotherhood of Jesus Christ, you're one of the terms that describes what a Christian is it means out of the same womb. We're from the same womb, not from Mary's womb. We're from the womb of the Holy Spirit of God. He gives us a rebirth. There's not many ways to heaven. There's one way to heaven. Turn in your Bibles or follow along with me on the screen. Do we have Matthew 7, 13 and 14, Miss Linda? Did you have that or no? Or turn in your Bibles to Matthew 7, 13 and 14. This is right out of Jesus's. I did that Sunday too, didn't I? I meant to say Jesus, but I said Gina. I give that woman a big head. Enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate, broad is the way that leads to destruction. And there are what? There are many, many who go in by it. Because narrow is the gate, and difficult is the way which leads to life, and there are few who find it. Now, years ago, I read a book by Steve Lawson, who, what a great writer he once at one time was. And he wrote about heaven. Can't remember the title of this book, but he explored this. And it was amazing to me. We really don't know if there'll be more people in hell than there will be in heaven. We don't know that. This is deep, but here's the reason why. The infant mortality rate in America is much lower than most other nations in the world. And we believe, because based upon what we learned from David, he cannot come back to me, but I shall go to him. We believe from that text and something that Moses wrote in the Pentateuch about the children of Israel going through the desert. And then Moses wrote that we shall go to them, children that are not accountable to God because they die before the age of accountability. All aborted babies, all babies who die in the womb, all children who do not understand and cannot understand the way of faith, God will take and be, they will be with us in glory. And they will know us and we shall know them. We don't know how many children have died in the ocean of humanity. So we really don't know. But when you look at the pearly gates and you study heaven, it is a huge abode that can house billions of people. And billions are alive now. There'll be many that die and perish rejecting him. Most adults choose the wide pathway. Most people that live into adulthood choose the wide pathway. Narrow, this is what Jesus was teaching. Narrow are those who choose. Few there are who choose the right way. So you've got to take into instance and into your mind, you've got to think about this tonight. There are many who think that their way is right. And they're on it. And they're going the way that they have chosen to go. And you and I, as we go and have chosen the narrow path, our job along the way is to allow them to know in a Christ-centered, loving way that their way is going to lead to destruction and death. I don't think that we can win them by bitterness. I think you have to win them by love and by the sugar of God's word. God teaches us through Paul, the apostle, in Ephesians, that it's by grace and faith, God's way. Look with me at what Ephesians 2, 8 and 9 teach, 8, 9 and 10 teach about salvation. Salvation is first God's work, for by grace you have been saved. Grace is, an acrostic for grace is God's riches at Christ's expense. I'm certain you've heard of that. God's riches at Christ's expense. Another simple way of remembering what grace is it's God's favor. God just throws you a bone. You didn't deserve it. You deserve death, destruction, separation from God. You do the time, you do the crime, you do the time. But God came to us through his Son, Jesus Christ, and gave us grace. For by grace you have been saved. Go with me back to Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1 tells us something more about grace than what we just read in Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. In chapter 1, he says to us in verses 12 through 14 that we who first trusted in Christ should be able to praise of his glory. In him you also trusted after you have heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also having believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession to the praise of his glory. Ephesians 1. Then go with me to chapter 2. Verses 4 through 7. But God, who is rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up together and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. That in the ages to come, he might show his exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. You say, well, what exactly does that mean? Well, grace is not something you deserve. Grace is something you get. We teach our kids a song about Saint Nick. If you're naughty, you're not gonna get. If you've been nice, you're gonna get. But really, that's not true. I've seen your kids. We give the naughty ones just like we give the nice ones, don't we? We don't give our kids gifts because they deserve it or they earned it. That's an allowance. We give them gifts because we simply love them. Grace is God's gift simply because he loved us. And he didn't pick and choose who gets that, but he knows who would receive it, and he knows who would reject it. That's what Ephesians 1 and 2 is teaching about. He did this work for us. It was his act of grace. I don't know if you've ever seen pictures like this before, but Miss Linda is going to bring up on the screen a picture of some folks. These are pictures of, in India, there are some Buddhist and Hindus who will take hooks, and they will, some of them, you'll see them pierce all the way through their bodies. You say, how do they do it? I don't know. But they take these hooks and they'll pierce through their body. This gentleman, I brought this up on my computer today. This gentleman is hooked to the skin and to the muscle of his back, what little muscle there is in the back. He hooked all of these hooks into his back, and he's pulling a cart filled with nothing but luggage and thousands of pounds being pulled by this man in a wagon. Why is he doing that? Because he's working for his faith. And then there's jihadist Muslims who strap explosives. They put on a vest. And like 4 days ago, this gentleman went into a bridge in London and stabbed all these people, killing them. And then some pedestrians jumped on him, turning on him. They didn't know because he had strapped this vest on him that looked like it had nothing but explosives. Why would a person do that? Because he looks at those people, either Christians or innocent people, and he thinks they're infidels. They're rejecting the truth of the Quran, and he's declaring jihadist war on them. Why would people go and with box cutters jump on an airplane, train for over a year to fly an airplane, attack pilots in the cockpit, steal four planes, and drive two of those planes into the Twin Towers? Why would they do that? Because their religion teaches them that this is the way you earned your faith, and you get to go to heaven where you're surrounded by virgins who serve you all the days of your life, and that's how you obtain eternal life. You say to yourself, well, that's ridiculous. It's ridiculous to you and me because we've not been raised up in it. But to them, our faith that God just declares us saved and separated because of his act, they think that's crazy. We call it a gift. They call it nonsense and foolishness. Of course I've got to earn it. How many of you remember a movie about 30 years ago starring Robert De Niro called The Mission? Anyone? It's a great movie. In this movie, De Niro falls in love with his brother's wife. Or I don't know if it was his brother's girlfriend or the wife 30 years ago, so I can't remember. But they're fighting over her one day in the marketplace, and he kills his brother. Then he goes to his priest, and he gives confession, I did this. It wasn't known publicly who did it. He confessed to his priest. He didn't want to have the police arrest him. He was noteworthy in the public sphere, so his priest told him, listen carefully, this is how you pay penance for your sin. And the picture that's on the screen is Robert De Niro acting out this mission. He's got this huge bag that the priests are carrying to a tribal people out in the jungles. And he's got to drag this bag, this huge burden, for miles and miles and miles to the mission where this burden is unleashed. And all the people, the tribal people, get wares and goods and food because he's dragged this heavy burden to them. And that helped him to pay penance for his sin. Whether you light candles, listen, whether you light candles, or you put hooks in your back, or you strap a vest to your chest and go and try to blow people up on a bus or in a crowded subway, or you drive planes into the Twin Towers and kill innocent infidels, all in the name of faith, there's lots of pathways that lead to destruction. They might, and you say, well, I would never do any of those things. Well, there's a lot of people who will work for church. There's lots of people who will sing in a choir. There'll be deacons, teachers, pastors, people that sit in pews week after week after week trying to earn their way to heaven. Dale was a man in my first church who, the church needed more parking because we were growing, and we had nothing but acreage of trees. And this guy was a forester. He owned a big company. And so Dale came to me after church one Sunday and said, I'll take care of those trees if you let me haul them off. I'll take care of it. I'll get my bulldozer on it. I'll level it. I'll get rock. I'll bring the rock to it. I was like, well, we can't pay you, Dale. He's like, that's all right. His wife, Teresa, came to me and winked at me. She just said, this will get you into our house. So about 2 weeks in, after Dale had brought all this tree cutting equipment, he had cut down about an acre and a half of trees. I was surprised, no bill. He was taking all these trees off. He took me to his workplace. He showed me this huge sawmill that would cut the tree that we had on that land, the wood trees that we had. It cut it in so thin slices, and then they'd put it on wood material and make a veneered bench or desk or table. And he said, I make millions of dollars a year off this sawmill doing this as trees. So don't worry, preacher. I'm doing this because I need to do it. So I sat down in Dale and Teresa's house that night. Listen. I said, Dale, Teresa's been baptized before, but have you ever been baptized? No. Dale, have you ever given your heart to the Lord? No. Dale, would you like to do that tonight? Big tears. Yeah, I would. I'm like, let me lead you in that prayer. No. Why? I can't. Preacher, let me finish my work. Then we'll talk. I didn't get it. So I watched Dale for 2 more weeks go out there with a bulldozer, flatten that property, bulldoze it, bring load after load of crush and run onto it, not just big rock, crush and run. He made it nice. He said, now this was virgin land, so these rocks are gonna have to sit for the winter. When you need the pavement, let me know. I'll pay for that too. I'm like, Dale, we can't. He was like, don't worry, preacher. I made a boatload of money off these trees. It's not costing me a dime. So I went back out to the house. I was excited, you know, I was gonna lead him to the Lord. I was pumped. But he sat there just crying. I gotta do something else. What else do you have to do at the church? And I'm like, oh, I get this, Dale. You want to pay penance. You've come from a Catholic background, haven't you? No. Well, what kind of a background do you come? None. I can't tell you, preacher. But there's some crap. There's some dirt way down inside of me that I just got to work it out. And I said, Dale, Jesus came to earth and died for all of that. For all of the dirt, for all of that crud. He did that for us, and I showed him verses. He just sat there and wept, and Teresa was just crying. He wouldn't do it. He thought, he believed that he had to work. Are you like Dale? You don't have to strap yourself with a chest full of bombs or get on a plane or put hooks in you to be crazy off the deep end in some theology or doctrination that teaches you that you've got to work your way to heaven. That wouldn't be his grace if you did it. It is his work, not yours and mine. So salvation is God's work. Secondly, salvation is God's work in God's way. How does God say, what's the way to get the grace of God? To obtain his favor, how do we get it? What do we have to do? Have faith. Have blind, childlike faith. Through faith, not of yourselves, the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Trusting in God alone is what saves a person. That's called faith. Not faith in a religion. It's faith in the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross. Trusting in God alone. Psalm 23:1 says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. If he is your shepherd, then you follow him because he's leading you to the way. In fact, he said in John 14:6, I am the way. So you have to follow his way, not your way, the way that seems right to you or that seems right to millions or billions of other people. You follow his way. It's a simple way. It leads to not works, but it leads to his righteousness, which he gives you as a gift. So it's a gift given by Jesus Christ. It's God's work in God's way. The picture that I have is not the actual picture, but I tried today to find the picture of, this is what I came up with. There's this little girl, a story that I used years ago in this illustration. A little girl was perched outside her window on the ledge of her window, way up in a building, and a fireman was on a ladder like this, and his hands were outstretched to the little girl, and he was saying, jump, jump, you've got to trust me, I'll catch you. And the little girl had to have blind faith in the fireman and in that ladder that when she jumped, he could catch her. Why would I show you that? Because you get to a point in your life where you really just have to take a flying leap of faith. Now listen to me. If you think you're going to get there by works, when a little girl, no matter how prolific, I don't care if she's been taught how to dive off of a diving board and she does the most beautiful swan dive ever, it doesn't matter. No dive is going to go up. Gravity takes you down. All you have to do is fall and jump out of that window into the arms and you'll be saved. Her decision was burn or jump. And it didn't have to be a pretty jump. It just had to be a jump, a leap of faith. That's where you've got to land. You've got to determine in your mind, it's not how you're able to jump, your ability to jump, your mindset to jump. At some point, you've got to see the fires that are going to get to you and to me, and you've got to say, all of our works are as filthy rags. I've got to take a flying leap of faith. Faith is taking a leap into something that you don't understand, something that you just accept that by his grace, his favor, he's wanting you to jump and take a leap of faith into his arms outstretched for you and me. You must rest in Jesus Christ. Gravity takes you down just like sin. The saving is in the hands of Christ. He is your fireman. And he's perched outside of a window saying, jump. How many of you remember Kirk Cameron? Did a show years ago, Facts of Life, and fell in love with a girl who told him she wouldn't date him because he was lost, secular. And he started studying the Bible, and he came to saving faith. And he's become on fire with God, and he and this other pastor named Ray Comfort have a website called Way of the Master. And years ago, they had as a awesome illustration of this, there was a firefighter in California who was charged and convicted of a crime, and here was his crime. There was a fire in a house, and the fire squad and the fire team was called out. The truck went out of the fire station. This fireman put on his suit, put on his hat, he had all of his gear and equipment. He got into the fire truck, and he was the operator of the ladder. But when he should have been on the truck maneuvering the ladder to a window in the second story for these children to jump out and jump to safety, he was in the hub of the truck. And here's the reason why. He had purchased the chief of the fire station a Christmas gift. It was what was called a VCR. And no one in the fire squad knew how to run and set up the VCR. So he was in the hub of the truck reading the directions to the VCR, not knowing that he needed to be out there. He was charged with manslaughter, involuntary manslaughter, and convicted because he didn't do his job, and three children perished by smoke inhalation because the ladder was not lifted up to the second window. No fireman could get into that house. Two things about that. There's reasons why I'm telling you. You and I have the Word of God. We have what's called Who's Your One. We have the ability to raise up the ladder of Jesus Christ and help them to say, hey, all you have to do, jump. Jump like a child. Get on this ladder and you'll go safely down because you're in burning. You're going to die. People are perishing. Secondly, it is our job to raise up that ladder. But then a person, and maybe you're here tonight like this, You know that you're lost like Dale. And you've got reasons, explanations why you're still in the window and the room that's got smoke and filled with fire. And you know where you're headed, but you think you've got time. So you're bartering, gambling with time that maybe God will give you more time, or that you'll just, because of your age, you'll have no time. But no man, no woman, no boy or girl has a guarantee. There's no warranties of life for tomorrow. Today could be your last. And you know where you're headed. So you need to make a choice. Do you take a flying leap of faith? Salvation is God's work done God's way. And thirdly, salvation is God's work in God's way and according to God's will. It's according to God's will. The reason that's there to say, here you go. It's not by works that we get saved, but after we're saved, you'll show by works. I've used this illustration many times, but if you gentlemen walk out of your house and on your way out of your house and home, you take your wedding ring off your finger and you put it in your pocket, and your wife is happening to look out the window to wave at you as you go away from the house, and she sees you take off your ring and put it into your pocket. If you go to the grocery store and you see a beautiful woman going up and down the aisle, so you take your wedding ring off. If you're out on business and you're away from your wife and kids or your husband and kids and you don't want people to know, maybe you'll get more sales if they think you're single or you're available. So you just take the ring off. That's a sign of what you're ashamed of, and it's a sign of character. When you ask Jesus Christ to come into your heart, the first sign, the first indicator that you really are, you've fallen in love with him and out of love with yourself and the world, is that you're put under the waters of baptism. It's a sign and symbol that he died for you on the cross, that he paid your debt and he went into the grave, and that you believe he came out of that grave. Though he were dead, he came back to life. The words of baptism is buried with him in baptism, raised with him to walk a new way in life. If you're ashamed to be baptized, you're taking off the wedding ring because you're ashamed of what you've done. And I would have to say, it's you obey him because you love him. And if you won't obey him and follow through with him, it's because you still love the old way or the old self. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works. Watch this now. Don't leave the last part of that verse out. Which God has prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. If you're a Christian here tonight, this is good news. Listen. You're not doing good things because you're a good person and you're a better person now. Salvation is not a new and improved you. It's a new you. Did y'all get that? It's not a new and improved you. It's a new you. You don't even remember what you used to be like because old things have passed away. Behold, all things are what? They're new. They're new. It's not new and improved. You haven't turned over a new leaf. You've turned over a new life. And God has prepared that beforehand. He's got the map all written out. All you have to do is have Jesus Christ as your compass. His word becomes your map. And his word says, trust him each day. Salvation is God's work, God's way, according to God's will. This is God's will for you. God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And a repentance means this: turning from the way you're headed and jumping, taking a flying leap into the arms of Jesus Christ. Don't you worry about who's watching you or what your friends will say or what you have to leave behind. Don't you worry about all that. You just take a flying leap of faith into the arms of Christ. But preacher, I don't think I can live this life. No, you can't. That's why he gives you the Holy Spirit, who helps you, counsels you, becomes your schoolmaster. He takes you and teaches you the way that you should go. It's his will that he has prepared beforehand for you and I to walk in them. You have nothing to worry about if you'll take a flying leap of faith into his arms. Now, there's lots of things that could interrupt you from doing that tonight. There's kids, there's family, anything you want can get in the way. I hope you won't be like Dale. Just weep and weep and weep. I don't know, it was some sick, sadistic sin that Dale had in his life that he didn't think he could give up. But years after I left Ohio, I called Dale on the phone. I'm like, Dale, you've been bothering me. He's like, Steve, you've been bothering me. And I said, Dale, are you ready? I sure am. God has not stopped knocking on my door. And on the phone, Dale gave his heart to Christ. You see, God has a way of continuing to knock on our conscience. And we can't, Dale kept trying to earn it. But he learned he couldn't work his way to glory. You can't either. Father, that you would